Anyone? Please feel free. Anybody, unmute yourselves and pray.
हालेलुया, धन्यवाद 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 देते हैं प्यारे परमेश्वर। प्यारे प्रभु जी, तू महान सर्वशक्तिमान परमेश्वर खुदावंद, आपको धन्यवाद देते हैं कि आपने फिर से एक सुंदर मौका दिया प्रभु जी। वो प्यारे परमेश्वर, हमारे इंस्ट्रक्टर और हमारे प्रिय भाई बहनों के साथ परमेश्वर पिता, आपने हमें पढ़ने के लिए समय दिया प्रभु जी, सुंदर समय के लिए धन्यवाद देते हैं प्यारे प्रभु जी। हमारे मैम के लिए प्रार्थना करते हैं परमेश्वर, जो हमें पढ़ाएंगे वो टीच करेंगे प्रभु, हमारे हृदय की गहराई में प्रभु जी बसने के लिए और उसमें चलने के लिए प्रभु जी, आपके सम्मुख में परमेश्वर विश्वास योग्य बने रहने के प्रभु आप सहायता करिए पिता। मेरे परमेश्वर, हरे को अपने लहू में छिपा परमेश्वर, आपकी आत्मिक बातों को, आत्मिक ज्ञानों को प्रभु जी, ओ परमेश्वर, हमारी गहराई में, हमारे दिल के गहराई में घुसने के लिए प्रभु जी आप सहायता करिए प्यारे परमेश्वर। आपको सारी बातों के धन्यवाद देते हैं प्यारे प्रभु जी। आप भले परमेश्वर है, आप भलाई करते हैं और आपकी करुणा प्रभु सदा की है पिता। सारी महिमा देते हुए इस प्रार्थना को मांगते हैं प्रभु, सुन स्वर्गराज में ग्रहण कर पिता। आमेन।
Amen. Thank you, Rebecca, for leading us with that word of prayer. We will quickly review what we did in the last class and then continue, studying God's word from there. So, in the last class, we looked at the fact that the Lord Jesus has become our excellent model to follow when it comes to having a prayer life. He, despite being the Son of God, developed a strong relationship with the Father. He prayed during not just his regular day, and he always made extra time. We find that he would go far away from the crowds and be alone with the Father on a mountain in the wilderness. So basically that shows us that he gave a lot of importance for time with the Father and his prayer life. And because of this kind of a relationship that he had developed with the Father, we also see that his prayers were successful. Okay, successful in the sense, whatever he prayed, it was answered. And we see Jesus say that in John chapter 11, where he remarks that, Father, you already know, right, that you have you've already answered my prayers, and just for the sake of the people, I'm even speaking it out. Okay, so that is the kind of strong, successful prayer life that Jesus had. And we know that Jesus taught us that the disciples should at least be like their master, or the followers should come close to adopting the way the leader lives. So we as disciples of the Lord Jesus, in the area of prayer, we can be like him, and we too can experience success in our prayer life. God is not somebody who will design anything for us and say that he is not going to grant it for us. Obviously, if the Lord has designed prayer, it is so that we be successful in it. Okay, so we have the guarantee of God's answered prayers to us, because he is a God who listens to the cries of the righteous. He is a God whose ears are turned towards our prayers, and he is the one who said, ask and you will receive, seek and you will find, knock and the door will be open to you. So does God want to answer our prayers? Answer is yes. Very much. God wants to answer our prayers. No, he doesn't want to put us in a place where he says, okay, you ask, but I'm not going to give you. Right? So that is not the nature of God. When God opens the door for us, it's so that we can walk into it. So God wants us to ask because he wants to give it to us. Now, knowing all this, in the last class, we started discussing about reasons why people don't receive. Okay, and one of the main reasons that came out of our discussion was that we don't ask in the will of God. Okay, and we ask our own thing, and that is why we don't receive it. We ask based on our own desires, and the prayers don't get answered. Yes, so that can be one of the main reasons. And somebody else also pointed out that God's timing can be different, and there is in a sense a time of preparation or waiting that happens in our lives before we see the fulfillment of God's promise. And that time and that space is only meant for our growth. Okay, so those were some of the thoughts that came about. So we'll discuss a little more on that today before we go into the kinds of prayers which are taught in the Word of God and which we can incorporate into our own prayer lives. So more reasons for our prayers not being answered is the wrong kind of attitude that we carry. We could have bitterness, unforgiveness, pride in our hearts. Also, the wrong understanding of prayer, right? So without faith, when we go before God, or we just think that, like somebody mentioned the other day about shopping list, going to the mall, we don't realize who God is, what his nature is, and how we must approach him. That causes a failure in our prayer lives as well. And also not using the right kind of prayer. What is the right kind of prayer? We will study about it. Different kinds of prayers that we could use. For example, I'll just tell you, maybe the Holy Spirit is prompting us to pray in the Spirit regarding something, and we don't bother about it, right? We just leave it. We're like, no, it's okay. I will just say it in my own words. But we might miss out on the power which is released by actually praying in the Spirit, praying in tongues for that one matter. So what happened? We employed the wrong kind of prayer there, and therefore we didn't see the victory of God. Okay, so being led by the Spirit and using the prompting of the Spirit to pray in the right manner also helps us receive answers to prayer. Now, while we are talking so much about successful prayer, like for some of us, it can be like a formula. Right? Every time I pray, there has to be an answer. It has to be a positive answer. If that is not happening, then something is wrong. So what could happen is we might also end up doing the wrong things and having the wrong mindset when we approach God in prayer. So what is the wrong mindset here? We begin to think of prayer as a manipulative tool. Right? So if I want something, I will go to God. He has to give it to me. Right? I will fast 21 days. He has to change his mind and he has to give it to me. So prayer is not a manipulative tool. Right? So that is the wrong approach. When we use that wrong approach, we will not see success. And if we are wanting 100% success in whatever our desire is, right? We could not only be manipulating God, but we could also try to manipulate people through prayer. How is that? We begin to pray prayers which are as per our will. Maybe just an example, right? We could say that my son, he wants to be a doctor, but God, let him never be a doctor. I want him to be I want him to be an aerospace engineer only. So you just go before God and you just want to manipulate that. You want to make sure that whatever you desire is what happens. So what are you doing now? You want to control the choice of your child. You want to force them into a certain line of work. See, even God does not go against our free will. And we have to remember that. So we are not here to use prayer as a manipulating tool to manipulate God or people, because there are boundaries, right? And these boundaries are set by our free will. So I just gave you an example of a child and a parent praying their own will over that child. But This can be applicable in so many other ways, right? As a pastor, if I pray over my people trying to control and manipulate their decisions, that would be wrong because there are boundaries, right? If I try to pray a prayer to control the decision of the career that your son is going to choose, you know, I am trespassing the boundary that God has already set there, because you are a parent over your child and I am not the parent. So even as a pastor, I cannot try to interfere in that way. Or, you know, between a husband and a wife, they make their own decision. But me as an external personality, if I try to crisscross those boundaries, that those natural boundaries that God has set, you know, my prayers, my manipulation is not something that will work, and it is not supposed to be that way. So we have to honor the boundaries of God, honor the free will that God has given to human beings. We have to honor the, you know, the structures, the family structure, the church structure, the leadership. When we honor the boundaries that God has given us, even then, you know, our prayers will be successful. But if we don't have those boundaries, then, you know, we could go off on the wrong tangent. Also, you know, we cannot try to change God's word or God's overall plan over mankind. I have given you some examples earlier on, and I'm sure you understand what I'm saying. So when we stick to the will of God, when we stick to the boundaries of God, then we can be effective in our prayers. Okay. Now, some people say the example of Apostle Paul. They use the passage where he says that, you know, there is a thorn in my flesh. Okay. And God uses a thorn in the flesh to develop us and to develop our prayer life. Okay. So how about we read that passage first, and then I will come and explain that passage in a clear way for us and in the context of what we are discussing right now. 2 Corinthians 12 verses 6 to 10. Anybody, can you please go ahead and read that passage for us, please? Okay. Any volunteers?
2 Corinthians 12.
Yeah.
2 Corinthians 12, 6 to 10. For though I might desire to boast, I will not be a fool, for I will speak the truth. But I refrain lest anyone should think of me above what he sees me to be or hears from me. And lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, a messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I be exalted above measure. Concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord three times that it might depart from me. And he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly, I will rather boast in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong.
Amen. Yes, thank you, Divya. Thank you for that passage. So the reason we are looking at this passage is, see, this is an unanswered prayer, right? So three times Paul is saying that he prayed that this, excuse me, sorry about that. He prayed that this thorn in the flesh, okay, yeah, thorn in the flesh would be removed from him, but God responds by saying, my grace is sufficient for you. What happens? A lot of us as believers, we take this passage, right, as an excuse for unanswered prayer. And we say that, okay, you know, my prayer didn't get answered because God is allowing. That phrase is used, right? God is allowing this difficulty, or he is allowing this sickness. He is allowing this oppression. Now, in the last class, I clarified that God never puts sickness on us. Okay, so that we must be very clear about. So if we are praying against a sickness and it is continuing, as a child of God, knowing that, you know, God has a covenant of healing with us, we can continue to press in for healing, okay? Because that is the right perspective. Now, it may happen, the healing may happen right away, or it might take several days or even, you know, much longer than that to manifest. That's all right. But at least you're pressing in the right direction. In this case, however, Paul's case, the thorn in the flesh that he is talking about, it is quite clear. It's not a sickness that, you know, God is saying, I will not heal you. God, that's not the point, because we know he himself says that it is a messenger of Satan. So what is the thorn in the flesh? It is a demonic power. And this demonic power was oppressing Paul. And God, for whatever reason, he did not take it away. Okay? Even though Paul prayed 3 times. Now, how is it and why is it like this? The thorn in the flesh, for the sake of Paul, you know, God, we could say that, you know, the prayer didn't get answered because, you know, Paul had an abundance of revelation. When you look at major part of the New Testament that he wrote and all that he claims about revelation, you know, Paul is an unusual personality in that sense. He's one of those foundational apostles who had a revelation that none of us can compare with. Okay. And we also know that the kind of foundational apostles who existed, we no longer have those ministers with us. As in, nobody is going to change the revelation of God's word anymore. Okay. Because it's already written. So we cannot claim any new revelation which is contradictory to the written word of God. Okay, now some of us might say, I have a revelation on this truth. Yeah, it's already there in scripture and God is enlightening us further in that truth. Okay, nothing new that we will add to scripture. But the kind of ministry that God gave Paul was he was writing out that new revelation for the first time. So here is a man who has incredible revelation. Okay. Now, we could say that, you know, God probably did not take away that spirit to keep him depending on God, because the level of Paul's revelation is incomparable. Now, if I take this passage and I say, I have a thorn in the flesh and God is not answering my prayer, it wouldn't be correct, because I'm comparing myself to the revelation of Paul, which I cannot compare. I don't think anybody can compare, right? And that was a reason why only in this case that demon was not stopped, okay? And so for us to apply this in our lives would be wrong. It would be incorrect. So taking this example to say that, oh, God is not going to answer, there will be some thorns in the flesh, okay, would be wrong. So we don't have to wait on any thorns in the flesh. This is a unique case, this 2 Corinthians 12. But like Jesus, we can expect the answer to all our prayers. Okay. Now, yes, there can be tests and trials. We discussed that in our earlier session. In that scenario, you know, definitely, you know, God will bring us out, and whatever we are going through, it will only cause our growth, provided we respond to God in the right manner. Okay, but it's just a matter of time that before we see the victory. So does God intentionally put us in a difficult place to destroy us? Answer is a big no. Okay, and therefore we can always look to God, confidently go to God to receive his blessings, receive his guidance, receive his deliverance, receive his healing. Okay, we should not use these one-off examples in scripture to justify our lack of pursuit of answered prayer. Okay, I hope that's clear and I hope there's no confusion about that. Would you want to ask any questions in along the same lines or give some comments? Okay, so Joash says it's clear. Okay, Nicholson. Yes, Nicholson, please go ahead. You can ask your question.
I popped in my head, so I just want to ask it. Just want to know,
sure.
If we are called to be like Jesus Christ and do, it says in certain scriptures we would even do greater things sometimes. But Paul was human, end of the day, right? So technically, I'm just saying, if we have the faith, we would also do amazing, crazy things like Paul and probably greater than Paul. So does that add up anywhere, or am I wrong in saying that?
No, you're correct. You're 100% correct that we are called to do greater things. And that was the experience of Paul, the apostles, and the early church. You know, once Jesus ascended, they saw an incredible number of miracles and supernatural works take place, even though Jesus was not personally doing them. Okay, and today we too can expect maybe even more amazing than what Paul and Peter and the apostles saw. So we are not comparing to that, Nicholson. What we are saying is, when it comes to this passage, okay, this passage, it specifically deals with the revelation and the abundance of revelation that Apostle Paul had, and that grace, right? So that grace is an apostolic grace. And even in the apostolic grace, the apostles that came after scripture was already written, their grace is different. So can anybody have the kind of apostolic grace that Paul had to write out scripture anymore? Answer is no, we cannot have it, because that calling was only upon his life, right? So that same calling will not be upon the life of anybody else. Now, because of that calling and because of that nature of revelation, this passage exists, that, you know, he says, because of the abundance of thing, thorn in the flesh was given. He's a messenger of Satan. And I prayed to God 3 times. But, you know, God said, my grace is sufficient for you. So that apostolic calling and grace, we cannot have. But yes, we can do greater works. Okay, we can do greater works in the calling, in the grace, in the work of the Holy Spirit that is given to us. So does that make sense, or does it confuse you?
Not perfectly. Thank you.
Okay, great. Yes, thank you. Thanks, Nicholson. Good question there. Yes, Rosalind has a comment here. Ma'am, is it possible for us also to have the thorn in the flesh? What if we have to have that grace at Paul? So yeah, Rosalind, that's what I'm clarifying. I'm saying we can't have. Okay, because the grace upon his life was of a founding apostle. And that founding apostle grace is already over. 2,000 years ago, God gave that grace to people like Paul and, you know, James and Apostle John and Apostle Peter. They've already written scripture and they've gone. So we can't have it. Answer is no, we can't have that grace. Okay, and because they had that grace, and particularly Paul, who had greater revelation even in comparison to other apostles, the thorn in the flesh happened to him. So, answer to your question, is it possible for us also to have a thorn in the flesh? Answer would be no. Okay. Does it make sense, Rosalind?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, sure. So, point we are saying is, see, we can use this passage to say that I'm not getting an answer. God is allowing this problem. We shouldn't do that. Instead, okay, I'm not getting an answer. Why am I not getting an answer? Scripturally, let me see. Okay, is it about faith? Okay, if it's about faith, let me read, the word of God more in this area for my breakthrough. Okay, if it's not about faith, if it's about the wrong kind of prayer that I'm praying, okay, let me pray in the right way. If it is about me asking my own desire, okay, let me ask in the will of God. So basically, if we don't have an answered prayer, then we look at scriptural reasons. Why am I not having an answer? And then you try to pursue God with what the Holy Spirit, you know, leads you with. Okay, but don't give up and say, it's a thorn in the flesh, just like Paul. We can't compare with that passage. Okay, so that was the point we were trying to make. So I think that must be clear enough. So if there are no more questions on this topic, we can proceed ahead. Okay, so chapter 5 in our notes here, I'm on page 18, has to do with the various kinds of prayers that we find in scripture. Now we can learn about them, we can also apply them in our own prayer lives. One foundational scripture for different kinds of prayers is from Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 18. It'll be good for somebody to read it, please. Anyone, can you read Ephesians 6 and verse 18?
Ephesians chapter 6 verse 18.
Okay, yes, please go ahead, Abubakar. Yeah.
Pray always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplications for all the saints.
Yes, thank you. So if you've noticed here, it says praying always with all prayer. Okay, all prayer referring to different kinds. All meaning there must be more, right? There must be a category of prayers. So what is this category? If you read other translations, there's a Godspeed's translation which says every kind of prayer. So there are kinds of prayers. There are categories within prayer. So we can actually know what these categories are, and we can apply them in our own personal lives. Even if we read the passage from 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 1, that also enlists certain categories. I think it'll be good to read it. So 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 1, please. Can somebody read that passage for us? Anyone? We'll be reading a lot of scriptures today, so I want us to be alert and quick so we can save time. So can somebody read 2 Timothy 2:1? Sorry, 1 Timothy 2:1.
1 Timothy 2:1. Therefore, yeah. I exhort first of all that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men.
Great. Thank you, Divya. So you notice there are categories, right? Supplications. What else does it say? Supplications then?
Prayers.
Prayers. Then what else?
Intercessions and yes. Giving of thanks.
Okay, great. Thank you. So, four different terms used to approach God. So that in itself says that there are types, kinds, okay, categories of prayers. So we can understand each one of these kinds of prayers and learn how to use it. We could pray a certain kind of prayer for the most part, or have a combination of these prayers. Either way, you know, whatever works and however the Spirit of God is leading us is what is the appropriate type to use. So the first kind of prayer is that of asking and receiving. And I think for all of us as believers, this is the simplest form of prayer which we learn. And even before we come to trust in God, I'm sure, you know, in your memories, if at all, like for me, yes, I could look back before I believed in God also. Asking and receiving was a common understanding. Like you can ask and you will get it. So this is there in the Word of God. And what is this prayer? Basically, you come before God with a request. Okay, and that request is granted to you. We already looked at the passage of Matthew 7 in the last session where Jesus said, ask, you know, seek, knock, then you will receive that answer to your request. Okay, there are two more passages. I think it is good that we read it. So Mark 11:24. Can somebody read it, please? Mark 11:24. And then John 16 verses 23 and 24. So one person can read Mark, the other person can read John.
Mark 11:24.
Yes, Silly Tony.
Therefore, I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them.
Thank you. You see, Jesus is talking about asking whatever things you want, desire, you ask and you will have them, right? Okay, great. John, what does it say?
In that day, you will no longer ask me anything. I tell you the truth. My Father will give you whatever you ask in my name.
Yes.
Until now, you have not asked for anything in my name. Ask and you will receive and your joy will be complete. Amen.
Yes. Yeah, thank you, Rosalind. So you notice here, all these three passages are encouraging us to ask God, okay? And God wants us to ask about different things that concern our lives. I know that at every stage in our lives, our asking is different, right? But we can continue to ask Him. We can continue to ask Him for spiritual things. The way in Psalm 27, you know, David writes, he says that, you know, one thing I have asked, and that is only you, God, you know, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to inquire, you know, in the house of the Lord. So those can be the things that we ask, can be those spiritual things where we say, God, you know, I want only you. I want your presence. I want greater understanding of your word, oh God. I want deeper revelation of your word. So we can ask for spiritual things. We can also ask for the natural things, because isn't it the Lord Jesus in the Lord's Prayer who taught us to say, okay, give us this day our daily bread. Okay, so my wants and needs for this natural world, I bring before the Lord. I ask Him. Or maybe depending on the place where you are in your life, you have decisions to make. You know, some of us, we have decisions to make about education. What will I do next? Some of us have decisions to make about our jobs. You know, what career will I invest my time in? Or some of us have decisions to make regarding a life partner. Who should I be with to fulfill God's purpose for my life? Or, you know, you have decisions about ministry. You have decisions about family. Whatever it is, the Word of God encourages us to ask. And Jesus said, so far, when He was here on the earth, they did not ask, but you know, he encouraged them to ask and said, whatever you ask in my name, I will do it for you. So this comes from God, this nudging for us to ask. You know, we can go before Him with our prayers, and God is faithful no matter what prayer it is, about the spiritual matters or about the natural matters, about making decisions. You know, God is saying, you ask me and I will answer you. So we must seek the Lord. So there is this simple prayer of asking and you receive, right? So what happens when you ask? The whole point is that God wants to give to us. He wants to respond to us and He wants to, show us that, you know, He has done this mighty work in our lives. So there are so many examples of asking and receiving from our own personal lives. Okay, I don't know which example to actually share with you, but okay, let me share this. This happened last year when we had to make a decision regarding the online Bible college. And as a team, we were thinking about it, and Pastor shared with us that he had decided to open up the online Bible college to not just India, but other countries as well. And at that point, you know, he told us, why don't we all by faith believe that people will register from at least 30 countries. Okay, I think 30 was the number that he gave us. And he said, pray together with me, agree together with me. We will believe God. We will ask him for people to register from 30 countries. And, you know, for all of us, it was the first time ever, right, that we were opening it up internationally, the Bible College online. So for me, I was like, 30 countries, how is it possible? You know, it's a lot of countries that we're asking for. But I was like, okay, as a team, we are believing. Let's go ahead and pray. But you will be amazed to hear that once the applications, we invited applications, it was easily above 30 countries, right? Like the number of students who applied and the countries that they applied from, it was above 30. And, you know, that was a prayer that I just can't forget. We asked God, we received more than what we asked him for. And, you know, it was such an encouragement for us that, wow, when we opened it up globally, the very first batch, you know, we are having from over 30 nations. Okay, and that's an example I just wanted to share with us. And I'm sure that there must be so many examples that you have. So you ask, right? You ask by faith. You ask in the name of Jesus. Why? Because God wants to give it to us. Okay, and God can do it. So this is the simple prayer of asking and receiving. Now, we will look at another type of prayer or a kind of prayer, which is the prayer of supplication. Okay, the supplication prayer, this is also an asking and receiving prayer, but the term supplication has to do with earnestly, asking very earnestly, okay? Or you could also use the term like desperately pleading entreating, crying out to God. In the Bible, when we hear of the blind man, you remember the blind man who called upon Jesus in Matthew chapter 20? He said, Son of David, you know, have mercy on us. Have mercy on us. He was crying out to God when the multitudes were rebuking him and saying, hey, you know, keep quiet, don't make noise. But he kept calling out, and the Lord Jesus actually responded to him. Jesus asked him, what do you want me? What should I do for you? And then, you know, he told the Lord that he wants his eyes to be opened. So this kind of a prayer where you are earnestly asking God, crying out, pleading. Okay, you can also use the term begging. The way this blind man was begging and asking God is called as supplication. And there can be times in our lives when we are not just, you know, saying, okay, God, I want this to happen, but it's more of a desperate thing, like, God, you know, I really want you to open up a door for ministry, and you have to make a way for me, right? So you're pleading before the Lord on that one particular request. So this is a prayer of supplication. We can supplicate, right? We can come and we can, you know, keep asking the Lord. And it might involve some, you know, like what do you say, emotional, passionate asking of the Lord. But it's very much a part of scripture. So if we are making supplications to the Lord, it can be about, you know, various things, maybe some concerns, current concerns, which we have in our family. And we are saying, Lord, you know, we want a breakthrough. We want a financial breakthrough. And every day you're praying about that. Every day you're calling upon the Lord, you know, passionately, emotionally. You're just calling upon the Lord and saying, God, I want to see, Lord. I want to see a turnaround in this situation. What are you doing? You're bringing in a prayer of supplication before the Lord. And even Jesus, you know, he also, the Bible says that when he lived here on the earth, he had supplications that he made to the Father, And particularly if you recall at the time when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane, he was crying out to the Lord. He was, you know, seeking him very passionately about one particular thing, which is for, if possible, for him to escape the pain of the cross. Okay, so Jesus also prayed prayers of supplication. So supplication is nothing but asking and receiving, but a prayer where you are very earnestly pressing in to the things of God. All right, yeah. Now, moving forward, the next kind of prayer that we have here is the prayer of intercession. So as the name itself gives us a clue, intercession is to stand on behalf of someone. Okay, in the passages that we read earlier, we saw this term intercession. You know, Divya also read it, intercession. And intercession simply means having someone pray for us. Now, in the case of Job, you know, if we read a couple of passages, I think I will ask us to read it. One is Job chapter 9. Verses 32 and 22. And another person can read Job chapter 16, verse 21. And then, you know, I will be in a better position to explain it to us. So can two people read these passages, please? Job 9 and Job 16. Anyone?
For he is not a man as I am, that I might answer him, that we should come to trial together.
Yeah, thank you, Rebecca. Job 16.
I need someone to meditate between God and me as a person meditates between friends.
Amen. Okay, yes, thank you. So, you know, when Job was going through a very difficult phase in his life, he asked for somebody. Okay, in the first passage, I think Rebecca read one verse only, but there are two verses there where, you know, he says that I wish there was somebody who could go before God for my sake. And in what Jeffina read, you know, he says, okay, I wish there was somebody to mediate between God and me, because he was in a situation where maybe he couldn't even pray to God. Okay, he was going through so much in his life. And what is the cry of his heart? Is there anybody else who can pray for me? Please. Okay, so that was what Job expected. Now we know in what God has provided for us as prayer, we have the opportunity to pray on behalf of others. Okay, now those people, they might be praying for themselves, or maybe they're in a position where they cannot pray for themselves. Whatever the situation, we can pray for others. And, you know, we will study later that this manner of praying for others is also a ministry where we can bless others. You know, we stand in the gap for them. And I think I've shared this a testimony with our class earlier that during COVID, you know, during the second phase of COVID here in India and here in Bangalore City, we had so many people being affected. So as a church family, we had those 40 days of prayer, which was going on online early in the mornings. And just as a result of that, you know, we have heard testimonies how people were healed, how people were protected. So what was actually happening? There is a bunch of people. This bunch is standing in the gap, or they are praying for another set of people, right? And, you know, that is an incredible blessing. We can intercede for someone. We don't even know whether those people are in a position to pray for themselves. But, you know, one kind of prayer is intercession. You and I can pray for others. Others can pray for us. And God has made it in such a way that this initiative of ours, or this effort of ours, that it will be a blessing. It will strengthen the other person. It can, you know, bring them out of their situation or circumstance which they are facing. So intercession is a another beautiful kind of prayer that we can engage in, and it is all about praying for others and not for ourselves. The next category of prayer which is recorded here is the prayer of thanksgiving. Can we see this in scripture where we go before the Lord to adore him, to praise him, to worship him, to thank him? Even when we start our classes, many a time the prayers include, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this opportunity to learn your word. You know, we thank you for every blessing that you have given us, right? So what's happening? It is a part of our prayer. It's not an asking and receiving kind of a prayer, but it is more of a thanksgiving. It is more of an adoration. It's more of a praise. It's more of a worship. Lord, we thank you because you are so faithful. This morning in the supernatural hour, we sang, Great is your faithfulness, O God. Okay, we sang that song. It's thanksgiving from our hearts. So thanksgiving, you can express it during your worship, but it can also be very much a part of your prayer. We do see prayers of thanksgiving in the Word of God, and it's a beautiful time of prayer, you would all agree, right? Sometimes just engaging in prayer and just spending a couple of minutes, or even like half an hour, 1 hour, or everything you can think of to worship the Lord, everything you can think of to thank the Lord, it's never enough. It's never enough. And just as you engage in the prayer of thanksgiving, there's that presence of God that you experience, right? Because you are encountering the nature of God as we begin to thank him for his goodness, for his mercy. What's happening? You're beholding his beauty, right? This is who he is. This is how faithful he is. This is all, this is what he has done in my life, right? So the prayer of thanksgiving, and enter his gates with thanksgiving. So many times in our prayer, we begin with the prayers of thanksgiving. Okay, and that's a huge part of our prayer lives. All right, so I think we will stop here for today. We just have another 2 minutes to go. And before we wrap up today, if there is anything you want to share about any prayer of asking and receiving that you have experienced, or intercession or thanksgiving, or supplication, that would be nice. Very briefly, very quickly, if you can share how you prayed and how God answered, that will be encouraging for the class.
Can I share?
Yes, please go ahead, Jeffina.
Yes. First of all, thank you for this opportunity to share my experience. Myself and my father were separated for 15 years for some reason. So we lived in some other place, and my father lived in some other place. So as a girl child, I really, really missed my dad. Like, when going to school, when other people draw, when other dads draw their child, I was like, my dad is not with me. So that hurted me for a long time. So 15 years, I lived with a lot of pain. And the last 3 years before that, I came to know who Jesus is. I came to know how to pray. I came to know that he already did everything on the cross for me. So what I did was, I thank God, like I confess that my dad is here. I believe that, God, you made a way for my dad to be here. And then finally, he wrote some exams to come here to have a job. First time he failed, second time he failed. And for the third time when he was going to write that exam to come here, I was the one who prayed. I was a very little girl. I was doing my 8th grade in school. And I said, it was a very fun prayer, I'll say, because I was very little. And I said, God, you raised up on the third day. My dad is writing for the third time. Let him come here, make a way. I know you can. All of a sudden, out of the blue, I prayed that day. And he failed that time too. But the government changed the rules for him to be passed. And that was a great miracle. And then it's been like 6 to 7 years my dad is here. So that is one of the great change in my life. And I'm thankful for that forever.
Wow, thank you, Jeffina. And, you know, that's a personal story that you've shared with us. Thank you for doing that. But, you know, we're so encouraged to know that God has answered your prayer, a simple prayer, because as a child you prayed. And that's the God we serve, right? So he sees our heart, and you asked, you received. How beautiful.
Amen. Thank you.
Thank you. Very encouraging. Very encouraging. Yeah. So I think we have run out of time. Let's close today, and we will continue on the different kinds of prayers from the next class. So I would like to request one of us to please pray and close today's class, please. Anybody, could you lead in a word of prayer? Okay, anyone, just volunteer.
Can I please?
Yes, Isaac, please go ahead.
Okay. At this moment, we want to thank God for answering prayers. And just in our example, he stated in the prayer of asking and receiving that you in the APC asked for the operation of the online Bible class or college outside India, and it happened. We want to thank God that we are beneficiaries of that particular prayer, and we continue to employ God to always answer our prayers, because he has promised that he will answer us. And we pray that he always give us the right direction where we can ask, or where we can intercede, or where we can pray, how we can pray so that our prayers can be effective. We ask that everything that we have benefited and will continue to benefit out of this prayer, now that we are students of this college, we pray that more students will avail of the courses. We want to thank God for all the life of all you who are the faculty members. We pray that also we who are students can benefit more, and more people will benefit out of this prayer that you prayed. We assure you that your prayer was answered. We thank God for answering prayers. Thank you, everybody. God bless us all.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Isaac, for leading us. And once again, thank you, everyone, for connecting. We will connect back again next week. God bless you. Have a good weekend.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye. Thank you. Bye. God bless. Thank you. Thank you. Bye. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.